Welcome to True Believers and the Road to Hell. We're joined today by Kevin Bixby, who is the executive director of the Southwest Environmental Center. Kevin has been an environmental activist, I would call it, and we'll let him describe himself, for decades, since he was in high school at least. He's been championing the issues for wildlife management and related issues over the decades, and been very passionate about it. He's recently started, or in the last few years has started, a project called Wildlife for All, which I'm sure he wants to talk about and will tell us about also today. But he's been one of the leading voices in New Mexico, and especially in this area of the state, on what we as a society should do on a lot of these environmental and especially wildlife issues, and how we should manage these things in a way that's compatible with the wildlife and respectful of the wildlife, as well as compatible with human activity. And we'll let him talk about these things for us. But Kevin, welcome.
Thank you. Good to be here, Michael.
Well, we're glad to have you. And one reason I want to talk to you is because I want to learn. I'm not particularly educated in a sophisticated way about a lot of these issues. And I hope you can help me, as well as whoever else is listening to this, learn a lot about some of these issues, and also want to know where you're coming from. I said that you've been doing this since high school, which I think is, if I'm right, is in the 80s. Am I right?
Well, I appreciate that, but it was a decade beyond that.
Well, okay, so go ahead. Give me a date. When were you in high school in Berkeley, California?
Well, I actually went to high school in Oakland, California, in the early 70s. Right. I remember Patty Hearst was kidnapped by the SLA when I was, I think a junior or senior, and we followed that drama. She was sighted all around the Bay Area, robbing banks and things. And yeah, and I was in high school sort of at the tail end of all the student protest out at Berkeley and the People's Park. And so I was a little young for that, but I still, it was still in my experience.
And apparently in your DNA, because you, as I understand it, you can correct me, that you've been an activist on a lot of these issues we're talking about ever since and over the decades. And what I want to ask you about, I want to get into some of that history at some point, but first of all, I want to check in with us today. I mean, where are we? How do you assess things today on the issues you're passionate about? And I guess the general question is, are we better or worse than we were when you started this activity?
Oh, I think there's no question we're worse. I spend most of my waking moments steeped in the metrics of how the world is unraveling, how the life support systems of the planet are unraveling due to human activities. Climate change is, people are generally aware of climate change now, and it's a pretty much of a minority contrarian view that climate change is not happening. But people are less aware of the other great existential threat to all life on the planet, including humans, and that's the mass extinction crisis that's happening, where we're losing populations of species, plants and animals, as well as species themselves, at a tremendously rapid, much more rapid rate than would occur if humans were not on the scene. Estimates of like 1,000 times as fast. Basically, we're watching ecosystems unravel as we, for whatever, however cause, whether it's habitat destruction, converting natural habitats to agriculture, or you know, subdivisions, or pollution, or over harvesting. We have these myriad ways that we're doing this to planet, and by many metrics, things are much worse than they were back in 1970 when the first Earth Day was celebrated. So, I have to keep going. My approach is we have to have hope and keep operating as if things will change. And it's quite likely, I mean, it's not quite likely, but if you don't have that mindset, things will not change.
You get nothing done if you don't.
Yeah,
and a little bit of optimism.
And, I think it was Milton Friedman. And, it's not like me to quote Milton Friedman, but because he's not one of my favorite economists. But he said that, and I'm going to paraphrase because I don't remember exactly what he said, word for word. But it was something to the effect of crisis brings opportunity. And things can change based on the ideas that are lying around. So it's important to have ideas lying around. And so that's what I try and do. I try and make sure that the ideas of protecting the planet and new ways of coexisting with nature and wild animals, those ideas are lying around for when the time comes. Hopefully it will come when society is ready to make those changes.
Well, by Milton Friedman's definition, we have lots and lots of opportunities then, don't we? Because there's considerable crises to play
yes.
on, I guess. If a lot of politicians use that phrase also, I think, in terms of never waste a good crisis or something like that. But
yeah,
but it's a little more dire in the when you're talking about existence. I think I saw recently in the last few days that there had been, and I know some of this it doesn't matter if it's official or not, but this, it was official by some measure that there were, I forget the numbers, but there was a pretty large, like 30 maybe, numbers of species that had been pronounced extinct. I don't know if you know what I'm referring to, but
I do.
I suspect from what you're saying that you'd say, and I'll let you say it, of course, but that's just the tip of the iceberg, and that's one measure that's late in the game.
Right. What you're referring to, I think, was the Fish and Wildlife Service, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, which is the agency responsible for administering the Endangered Species Act, a really important U.S. law that has been used to protect many species. But it's basically, it'd be the equivalent of saying this is no longer a rescue operation, this is a recovery operation. What they're saying is we've given up hope that these species still exist, so we're going to take them off the list. We're closing the books on them.
What does it matter? What does it matter that they're on that list or not? I mean, what as a practical matter, or as a matter of how we proceed? What difference does it make if a particular species is pronounced extinct, or just as a practical matter, can't be found? Does that list actually make a difference in policy somewhere?
Yes, it's an incredibly powerful policy tool for staving off extinction. And what it does in a nutshell is, for most species in the United States, the states have, the tradition is that states have primary jurisdiction over wildlife. But the federal government will assert jurisdiction over certain categories of species, including those that are listed under the Federal Endangered Species Act. And when that happens, all sorts of protections come into play that would not be brought to bear otherwise. For example, suddenly there are, well, for one thing, the states can no longer do as they want with those species. And that's huge because, for example, with gray wolves, most of the states don't like wolves, frankly. I mean, that's the way their state wildlife management systems are geared towards a sort of, you know, against predators like wolves. So it puts restrictions on what the states can do. It is supposed to trigger proactive programs to recover those species, and it usually does. And that's one reason why gray wolves have made a comeback. They were mostly wiped out in the lower 48 states. They survived in Minnesota, but other than that, they were wiped out. And once they were listed as endangered, there were efforts made to bring them back here in New Mexico and Arizona. The Mexican gray wolf was reintroduced. In Yellowstone, the gray wolf was introduced. In the Northern Rockies and Idaho, they were reintroduced. And they did well as a result of the federal protection. So it's a tremendously important policy mechanism that we have, but it's a emergency room measure. It only comes into play when a species is about to go extinct. And that's absolutely the wrong way to go about wildlife conservation. You want to prevent species from getting to the point where they need the protection of the Federal Endangered Species Act. And that's what we're trying to do with Wildlife for All, our new campaign to really reform the way the states manage wildlife so that they pay attention to all species, not just the ones that hunters are of interest to hunters and anglers. You know, those are important, but there's a lot of other species out there that are also important in terms of their contribution, their role in natural ecosystems, and their intrinsic value.
I want to get to your, I know that the Wildlife for All is very important to you, and I want you to be able to talk about that. But I want to go back first to the act, the federal act, because I wonder, maybe you can speak about it in this perspective, and that is what you know about that and how it works as opposed to public perception. Because it seems to me that everything these days that has any kind of federal tag on it is seen through a partisan lens and just as a political matter. And you know, you've seen it more than anybody about people being or mocking the protection of certain species. If you have a minnow or a small bird or something that's being protected, and then there are these developers who come in who want to put a shopping center. I'm just making stuff up here, but you know what I'm talking about. Is that there's people who are saying, well, it ruins our economy to try to protect this little thing that nobody cares about, and that it becomes a political, or I'm just throwing that out. Maybe you disagree with that assessment, but isn't it made political in a lot of ways through that lens because people don't understand?
Yeah, no, I think you're right. It's an example of a law kind of like, emancipating the slaves. It kind of was ahead of the where the public consensus was for a lot of the country. And you know, when the Endangered Species Act was passed, I mean, it was revolutionary.
Was that a Nixon era?
It passed under Nixon, and it passed with only one vote in opposition in Congress. But I think a lot of members of Congress thought they were voting to save pandas and tigers, you know, and maybe in far off countries, just because it did have international implications too. It was
it had the cuteness it, factor, yeah, in other words.
And once we started getting to taxa that people didn't think were cuddly, like fish and snails, then there was this backlash, and that's been exacerbated with the divide in our country today. It was revolutionary, I mean, because it recognized, maybe not fully comprehended at the time, but that all species are important. And they were important in ways we were beginning to realize then, and we know even more about now. Every species plays a role in ecosystems, you know, forests and grasslands and wetlands and oceans that provide all sorts of free ecological services that make life possible on Earth. Clean air, clean water, nutrient recycling. You know, if we didn't have scavengers, the world would be full of dead bodies. I mean, and they would not recycle. So, I mean, there's all sorts of ways that natural systems sustain life, and we don't really know what the particular contribution is of each species, but we have to assume, and we know about some of them, and we have to assume that each species has some role to play. And Paul Ehrlich, a biologist at Stanford, he's made the analogy that losing species is like removing the rivets on an airplane. You know, you can remove one rivet here, one there, and it might continue to fly, but at some point you're gonna compromise the flight worthiness of the plane. It's gonna crash. And that's sort of the way it is with natural ecosystems. You can lose one species here, one species there, and you know, maybe you won't miss it. But after a while, you know, it's going to crash.
Structure collapses, right? Well, I'm sure there's pushback from various and disputes about some of the policies that should take place on this that I want to get to. But I want to ask you first. You're the executive director of the Southwest Environmental Center, and
And we've changed our name to Wildlife for All.
Oh, okay.
It's the same organization, and legally it's, you know, Southwest Environmental Center, DBA.
I misunderstood. I thought
it's working together with it. It's a brand new shift.
Okay, so when I went on the website and saw under the Environmental Center and saw Wildlife for All, it wasn't just a part of the Environmental Center, it's a replacement for the name, yeah, anyway. Okay, all right. Well, yeah. I'm sorry, excuse my
The press release went out last week, so you can be excused if you didn't know.
Okay, well, yeah, excuse my ignorance, but thank you for explaining that. Well, but the question is going to be, how much of this is, and what you do, is local, how much of it's state, how much of it's national? Obviously, we're talking about there being no line when you're talking about the existence of a species, including the human species. Lines aren't drawn by geographic boundaries, but I'm wondering, is New Mexico, for example, or Doñana County, for example, better or worse off than other places? Or are we all in lockstep on how good or bad we are?
Yeah, I think that, to answer the first part of that question, I think Southwest Environmental Center for 30 years was primarily a regional organization working in Southern New Mexico. So we have a lot of history of working on issues down here. And at the state level with legislation. But the new direction, Wildlife for All, is a national campaign to change the way every state manages its wildlife, because it's basically the same problem writ over 50 states.
And I can go. Can you put that in a nutshell? I mean, I know it's.
Yeah.
Can you put it in a nutshell for us?
The history of wildlife conservation in this country, in the late 1800s, there was basically there were very few laws, and they weren't really enforced as to how people could use wildlife. And there was an incentive for market hunters to, you know, take extraordinary numbers of game animals and sell them for, you know, to all sorts of markets. And once the railroads opened up, came across country, that opened up distant markets. So game populations and people also, you know, hunted for subsistence. That's how people got along. And that's been happening for 20,000 years in North America. But a lot of game species were almost wiped out, and probably other species that we don't know as much about as well. And that's when there was an effort on the part of folks like Teddy Roosevelt and Gifford Pinchot to get laws in place to regulate the take of wildlife. And that's how most state wildlife laws were enacted in the early 20th century. And that's when most state wildlife agencies came into existence to enforce those laws. But it was all very much focused on game animals like deer, elk, bighorn sheep, pronghorn, turkey, you know, things that people wanted to eat. And so that's how every state wildlife management system came into existence, and that was the focus, and that continues to be the focus today.
And what is the problem with that?
Well, it's
obviously there's a problem with it. So what is the change that needs to be made from that focus?
Well, okay, the change is we now know, as I was saying earlier, about the ecological value of all species, not just game animals.
Right.
So we know that all species are important. So that's a shift that we want to see the states make, is, you know, from focusing on a subset of game animals to all species and ecosystems. And the second thing is, you know, a lot fewer people, or relative to the general population, hunt or fish today than back then. And people's attitudes have changed towards wildlife. They view wildlife as, a lot of people view wildlife as more important alive than dead. You know, they're not interested in killing an animal for meat or for whatever reason. They're interested in watching it and do its thing in the wild. And that's borne out by the data. There's surveys that show that the numbers and on a relative and actual numbers and relative numbers, hunting has been on the decline for decades. The number of people and the number of people relative to the general population has been on decline. So what you have today is a system where in almost every state, you have a state wildlife agency that is focused on providing hunting and fishing opportunities and not on protecting all species and ecosystems. And it's also, the governance is very much skewed towards serving that shrinking number of people that engage in what we call consumptive uses of wildlife, hunting and fishing and trapping. And so you have these state agencies that are focused on serving those folks and really shutting out the majority of the public when it comes to making decisions about how wildlife should be used and managed.
So I guess I'm restating pretty much what you're saying. I hope is that hunters and fishermen have outsized political influence because of this focus, is what you're saying.
That's right.
And so then the decisions are made about not only where the protections are, but where the money's spent and where, you know, so forth and so on, to the at the expense of some of these other.
Yeah, and let me just give you an example of how that plays out. In Wisconsin this year, there was gray wolves were taken off the list of endangered, federally endangered species. That's one of the last things that Trump did before he left office. So he removed federal protections for gray wolves. Wisconsin had a law on the books that said if that ever happened, there should be a hunt. There shall be a hunt in Wisconsin for gray wolves. And the Department of Natural Resources there was prepared to organize, you know, and implement a hunt for the fall of this year, which is, you know, we don't really support any sort of hunting of wolves. It's not necessary to manage them, and people don't eat them, and generally they don't use them in any way. But if you're going to hunt them, you need to, it's best to start a hunt in the fall before the wolf breeding season. But the state was sued by a group called Hunter Nation with Ted Nugent on its board, and forced to call a hunt this year in February. And a lot of the wolves were pregnant. It was very hastily called. And over the course of 3 days, more than 200 wolves were killed, mostly by people using dogs and using snowmobiles at night. It was not anything that anyone would consider fair chase. A lot of people in Wisconsin and around the country, including a lot of hunters, were, you know, just opposed to this type of hunt. And yet it still went forward because the people that were calling the shots were this small minority of they're hunters, but there's a division within the hunting community. So, but the point is the general public has been shut out of decisions about how to manage wildlife.
Well, and how should
these, and it manifests itself in these kinds of occurrences.
Let me
and just one other example is I mentioned that we, you know, and I'm not anti-hunting, I actually am a hunter myself, but I would never hunt a carnivore like a mountain lion or a wolf because I'm not going to eat it. Most people don't, and I don't want to kill it for the sake of killing it, which is what you know people do. And I think most people feel as I do. I think polls back that up. But if I went to the, say, New Mexico Game Commission, which sets policy in New Mexico for hunting, and said, I don't think there should be any hunting of mountain lions, I would be, you know, say, okay, thank you very much for your comment, go away. Because the question is always, how many shall we hunt? Not shall we hunt at all? And that's an example of how excluding the majority of the public from these decisions plays out. And it plays out like that in every state.
Okay, but let me push a little bit on terms of how decisions are made, because obviously when you talk about polling and making and public perception and public or popularity of a particular position or whatever, I think about criminal justice sometimes, which is more my area. And I'd hate to think that polling made all the decisions in criminal justice, for example, because you could get polls to have people hung from the highest tree for jaywalking, you know, or whatever. Maybe this is a poor analogy, but the point is that I'm trying to raise with you is you've talked about public attitudes and polling several times. How should we can't vote on all these decisions. How should the decisions more properly be made, do you think? Obviously, you're right that you don't want to have an outsized, you don't want to have one demographic group have all the power. But how should the decision be made about whether we should hunt mountain lions at all, or what the number is, and that kind of thing?
Well, I'm glad you brought up the criminal justice system. I think that's a great analogy. So imagine if the jury of your peers, as it used to be, say you're a Black defendant, and the jury is all white because Blacks have been excluded.
Right.
That's exactly what we have today in wildlife governance. We have people making the decisions that represent a minority of the public. I agree, we don't want to make every decision by a popularity contest or majority rule, but we ought to have more democracy than we have today. But going beyond that, I mean, that just is, I think the system now is just fundamentally anti-democratic. But long-term, what I would like to see is decisions made according to public trust thinking. So, and there's a legal doctrine called the public trust doctrine, which holds that, well, as applied to wildlife, that wildlife is a public trust, and the government has a duty as trustee to manage and protect the trust for the beneficiaries, which are usually defined as all the people now and in the future. And I would expand that definition to include all life. But I would like to see wildlife decision-making aligned with public trust thinking, so that the people that make the decisions are not just listening to who's in the room today, but really thinking about what's best for the trust, for people that aren't, or beneficiaries that are not in the room today and who are not here, not even yet born. And that would be, I think, more like a Supreme Court model, where you're trying to get a group of people thinking not in terms of interest, but in terms of justice. And yeah. We're a long ways from there.
No, well, obviously these decisions are, and I want to, we're going to get back to what your opinions are as opposed to everybody else's opinions in a moment here. But obviously these decisions are sometimes, well, they're controversial, I suppose. It's some of them are anyway, and they're, at least there's disputes. There's not total agreement on what species are extinct or should be, or should be allowed to go extinct or whatever, right? I mean, there's all kinds of different, they may be ignorant, they may be based on ignorant notions, but there are disputes. So I guess the question is, how do you make decisions? And what I'm reminded of is the most recent dispute about how do you use science? Because there's a lot of people, when you talk about COVID, you talk about vaccinations, and you talk about masking and whether or not we should social distance or blah, 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 and what's good, what's bad policy. And people say, many people, myself included, say, well, let's look at the science. Let's see what where science leads us, not just political science, right? So, so you try to the extent you can, use good data and good educated, intelligent, well-informed people to give you information on which to make decisions. And I'm thinking that's similar to what you're saying in terms of how we address this issue, though it's a little bit different. Does that make any, am I resonating at all with you on this? Does it make any sense to you? I mean, is there objective truth somewhere about how these things should be treated, is there a universal agreement on how we should go forward?
No.
How we should go forward?
No, these are fundamentally moral questions, value questions. Science definitely has a role to play. Science should be used to inform decisions about, for example, how many mountain lions we allow people to kill in a given year. That should definitely come into play. But science can't tell us, again, if we should be killing mountain lions at all. You know, that's just a value decision.
Well, wait a minute. Why is that? I mean, because if there's a number at all, why can't it be zero? I mean, it could be zero, but science won't tell us that. Well, if you allow a species, whether it's a mountain lion or a bird or something, a fish, if you just don't touch it and let it work its own magic in nature, then we have predictable models, don't we, that can tell us that what the future holds for that species in terms of, you know, how it will populate and whether it will populate and so forth and whether it will survive, whether it'll be survival of the fittest, it will meet that. So can't science tell us that, look, if you just leave these mountain lions alone, everything will be fine and there will be a balance in nature, blah, 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 whatever. As opposed to saying, well, if you kill only 100 of them, then, you know, everything will be okay. I don't see that.
Well, that's the problem.
I don't see that science can't help us with both of those questions.
So, I can tell you what science will say is, if you kill zero, the population of mountain lions will regulate itself, and so it will not go extinct as long as there's available habitat. If you kill X number based on our models, the same thing will happen. It will not go extinct because there's always excess numbers. And the question is, what happens to them? And if humans take them out of the population, the numbers, if it's science is telling us how many we can take out without sending the population into a decline, that's all about the numbers. One thing that is often ignored, and actually science can help us with this too, although people want to ignore this type of science, but science will just tell us that when you hunt carnivores, the large carnivores are all territorial. You know, they will establish territories and defend them against others of their kind. And so it's really tough. So that's why, you know, others will have to go out and find, you know, young ones will have to go out and find their own territory. And when you have territories that are stable, you have stable social interactions among the population. When you start taking territory holders out, you create instability and you allow younger individuals to come in and hold territories. And it disrupts the behavior. And that's when you see more actually attacks on livestock. You see that with coyotes and wolves because their social structure has been disrupted and they now have to look for inexperienced individuals will now be looking for the easiest way to find food. And it often leads them into conflicts of wildlife. But I got distracted there. We were talking about science.
It's all right.
But the point is, in terms of numbers, the science will tell you can kill X number or you can kill zero and the population will not go extinct. But it's up to you to determine if you want to kill X or zero. That's my point, is science is not determinative. That's going to be a value decision.
No, it's not. But it's all. But science is something that is often used as justification for all kinds of decisions that we make. Sometimes, perhaps rightly, sometimes wrongly. I don't know. But it plays a role in how society makes decisions about. And don't you think that's a good thing that science is involved in the decision making a lot of times?
I do think that's a good thing. But as you say. And at least in wildlife decisions, whoever doesn't like the decision will hold up the banner of science and say, we've got to let science determine, because science is on my side. It doesn't matter which side you're on. That's, you always hear that, whether it's true or not.
So, okay. So if that's the case, then what's better? I mean, what you mentioned the public trust, but isn't that essentially, it's at some level that's science-based, isn't it?
At some level it should be. I mean, that's responsible trust management, but I think what it needs to be, it's going to be value-based. And I think that's where a decision-making process will be more like a Supreme Court, which will hear, you know, try and weigh everybody's interest. And in this case, the future's interest as well. And the beneficiaries, which are not actually, haven't made their arguments before the court. So, it really more like a jury or a court adjudication. And it's not just science, because I think what's missing with wildlife is that sometimes science is definitely missing, but there's very little acknowledgement that most decisions have some values behind them, and values are rarely made explicit.
Well, would you want,
and they should be.
It's interesting that I find it interesting as a lawyer to listen to you talk about to extol the virtues of our court system, you know, because obviously I do too, up to a point. But I guess I'm wondering, would you want the provisions of the Nixon era Endangered Species Act to be litigated by today's Supreme Court?
Not today's Supreme Court.
Yeah, well, see, I mean, because courts are political also. I mean, they have a political grounding, and that they're, like it or not, for better or worse,
well,
politicians making decisions about these things. And so I guess, but, you know, it's an unanswerable question. I don't mean to be unfair with it. So there's not an easy answer. I'm not suggesting there is, but I guess that's the point.
Michael, the Supreme Court has weighed in, and courts have weighed in probably thousands of times on Endangered Species Act cases. And, you know, that's great. I mean, I think it's better than not having them weigh in. And one of the great, one of the reasons why the Endangered Species Act is so powerful, it allows citizens to take the government to court to enforce the act. And as a result, there's been a lot of litigation, and a lot of cases have ended up in the courts. And yeah, it's political. I mean, everything can be political.
At some point, right?
Yeah. And the Supreme Court has actually weighed in on the snail darter back in the 70s. 80s.
80s, maybe, but yeah, in New Mexico, you mean?
No, this is the U.S. Supreme Court, and it stopped a very large, hydropower or dam development project in Tennessee.
Oh, okay.
Because there was the snail darter, the famous snail darter.
I was thinking of, anyway, go ahead. It doesn't matter what I was thinking.
Yeah, and that was hugely controversial. Oh, snail, I think it was George H.W. Bush railed against the decision. A snail, a tiny little fish stopped this, mega project, and everyone said, oh, the law's got to go. It's just no good. But what they did was they ended up finding a way to do both. And that's what usually happens. If the act forces an accommodation, and usually it works out for everybody.
You mentioned, I'm going to change subjects slightly. You mentioned livestock earlier and how I think it was relationship to wolves at that time. But I'm just wondering, what is your position or your organization's position on livestock? This is been a big issue recently in terms of, and maybe you don't have an opinion, but in terms of whether people should eat beef and how much beef, and how, if by the more cattle we have and more beef we have in the world, it's dangerous to the environment because of a number of reasons, including methane. Do you have an opinion on those issues?
My organization, Wildlife for All, does not. My personal opinion is the world would be better if the 8 billion people on it, ate less animal flesh, because there definitely is an environmental cost to raising animals. Having said that, I have friends who are ranchers who are doing a fantastic job. They're mavericks, they're pioneers in their in the ranching world, but they are trying to manage their cattle in a way that, you know, mimics maybe the bison or wild grazing animals. And as a result, there's more grass, there's more diversity of grass, it's better for wildlife in general. I mean, so if there's going to be livestock grazing, I think there are better ways to do it than, you know, most folks are doing it. But in general, I think we should all be eating lower down on the food chain.
That's interesting. I would think that your organization, Wildlife for All, it seems like an issue that's pretty related. I mean, the treatment of any animals for human consumption, especially cattle, I guess, would seem to have touched directly on the other species that you're trying to save. Am I wrong?
You're probably not wrong. It's just, you know, our focus is on policy as it relates to wildlife, not as it relates to public land management, for example. That's where grazing is a huge issue. Should livestock grazing be allowed on public lands? You know, that's, I personally think that, you know, I support the 30 by 30 and 50 by 50 initiatives. I think that public lands should be, biodiversity conservation should be prioritized. And in many cases, livestock grazing is detrimental to that.
So your issues, the things that you're trying to do, thank you for trying to do them, is it bumps up against these other interests, right? I mean, in terms of the grazing in particular, you mentioned ranchers, the ranchers who you said you designated them as mavericks, meaning they're not in the majority of the ranching industry or the grazing industry, right? And so isn't that where you get a lot of your conflict, is from organizations, from entities like that? When you have wildlife, when you're trying to preserve a particular, I don't know, whether it's wolves or fish or whatever it is, many times the pushback you get is not because people say, oh, we don't like those animals. It is because it's supposedly going to have an effect on their commerce, right? And on their businesses, and are going to kill their cattle or whatever it is. So those,
yeah.
That's where a lot of the tension lies, isn't it?
You're right. That is, so we're trying to change the status quo in state wildlife management. And that generally takes place at the legislature with the laws that govern how wildlife is managed, who manages it in a state. And before wildlife commissions in New Mexico, it's called a game commission. And with the agency itself, in New Mexico, it's the Department of Game and Fish. But you're right. A powerful defender often of the status quo is the agricultural industry. And so when I go to Santa Fe and I testify in favor of a bill for example, that will give our game and fish department authority to manage all the species within the state, which it currently lacks. One of the opponents will be the New Mexico cattle growers, and it will be many other agricultural groups as well, because they see that as a threat to their industry. I'm not sure why. I mean, it doesn't have to be, but that's, they see it that way.
So do you have common ground with those folks as well, though? Are there things upon which you agree that at least the goal, you agree on a goal, that just disagree on how to get there, or is it total disagreement?
You know, there are, like I said, there are ranchers who are willing to try things differently. So yes, I think, you know, I haven't personally experienced it too much in New Mexico. But I'd say, for example, a friend of mine up in Idaho is involved with this project, and it's a really cool project. She is working with ranchers, sheep ranchers in wolf country, and she's helping them do things differently, manage their sheep in different ways, give them the resources that they need to make those changes. And she's had tremendous success. They've had a lot less losses to wolves than neighboring ranchers that haven't implemented these changes. So yeah, I think there's common ground. I don't know if the ranchers participating in that project would then go to the legislature and support, you know, getting more non-hunters on the Wildlife Commission. You know, I don't know if it translates to that kind of support, but there's definitely common ground. I mean, at the end of the day, what we're talking about is how to coexist with wild nature. And the allies are the people that are willing to try to coexist, even if it means making changes. And our opponents are those who don't want to coexist with wild nature, who feel like humans are at the top of the pyramid, and that's how God ordained it. And humans have a right to do whatever they want, including destroy nature, if that's their pleasure.
That's a sad commentary.
It's sad, but I think
it's true.
I think the majority of the public in the United States is moving towards wanting greater coexistence. And I'm not just saying that because I think that. I've seen a survey.
Numbers, data. Okay. Well, on that note, I think we'll take a break and be back in a moment with Kevin Bixby on True Believers and the Road to Hell. 'Cause I fell.